In this video, we'll compare SQLite and Postgres as you asked me to do. We'll run a full CRUD test to measure insert latency, as well as updates and deletes. In the first test, we'll also look at throughput, which I'll explain later, CPU usage for both the clients and the database, and disk write operations. In the second test, I use SQL Join that combines multiple database tables to measure the read or select performance of the database. This is where the most significant differences show up. But first, let's define each database. Postgres is a traditional database engine with a client-server architecture. Typically, you would run a Postgres database on its own server, either on a virtual machine or a bare metal. It is a long-running server process that manages access to the underlying file system to store data on disk. For example, in Postgres, each table and index is stored in a separate file. When a table or index exceeds 1 GB, it is split into gigabyte-sized segments. If you have a multi-core server with 4 or 8 CPU cores, the database engine can coordinate reads and writes to those files. In some cases, it can even handle certain operations, including inserts in parallel. Usually, clients deploy it on separate servers outside of the database and communicate with it over the network. Network operations are slow and costly, so to improve application performance, a connection pool is used. This allows connections to the database to be reused. Despite network limitations, traditional databases can improve concurrency through a centralized engine with multiple worker processes or threads. On the other hand, we have SQLite, which is not really a database engine, but a library or a package used in your application to write data to the local file system. There is no client-server architecture with SQLite. Instead, you import the library into your code and use it along with SQL to interact with your file system. In this setup, your application effectively becomes the database engine itself. SQL database is always stored in a single disk file, and this is where its limitation comes from. Because it uses a single file, writing or inserting data to SQLite database is not safe to do in parallel. However, multiple instances or threads in your application can read from that file simultaneously. In short, SQLite supports unlimited number of simultaneous readers, but it allows only one writer at a time. It is possible to convert SQLite to a client-server architecture, but you would need to create interface or API to interact with a remote instance that uses SQLite for local data storage. Keep in mind, SQLite doesn't directly compete with Postgres or any other database with a client-server architecture. However, SQLite is one of the most widely used databases in the world. It is particularly common in embedded devices and Internet of Things. SQLite also has other use cases. It works well as a database engine for most low to medium traffic websites, which covers the most of the websites. In this niche, we can make meaningful comparison between Postgres and SQLite. It's almost impossible to directly compare SQLite and Postgres because they are very different. So I decided to compare them in a way that would typically be used in the real-world scenarios. I create a single EC2 instance for SQLite, which is essentially my Go application using SQLite as a library. I choose i3en large instance with a local SSD disk. This instance has 2 CPUs and 16 GB of memory. Now, for the Postgres, I also create EC2 instance using the same type. However, I deploy the client on a different virtual machine using M7A large instance. You might already predict the results, but my goal for this test is to show the real difference and illustrate how the network impacts database latency. SQLite interacts directly with the local file system, while the Postgres client needs to send requests over the network. This setup reflects how Postgres is typically used. If you want me to deploy both Postgres and client on the same server, let me know and I can release another video. It is possible to collocate them, and I believe some websites like WordPress run MySQL and PHP application on the same instance. Anyway, feel free to suggest improvements to the design of this test. For SQLite, I use write-ahead log, which is significantly faster than the default rollback journal in most scenarios. I also disable sync and enable foreign key support. Now, for the first test, I simulate a shopping cart. There are 6 tables, and 2 of them, product and customer, already have 10 records each before the test begins. So, for the first test, we first create a shopping cart. Then we add the first item to the cart and update the value of the cart. Next, we add the second item to the cart and update the total value again. After that, we create an order. We transfer the first item to the order and reduce the stock quantity for that item. Then we add the second item to the order and reduce its stock quantity as well. Finally, we delete the shopping cart and the cart items. Some of these operations would typically be included in a single transaction. However, to measure the latency of each operation, I perform them independently. For the second test, I use a join that combines multiple tables to select items that the customer purchased. Each time I run this query, I generate a new order ID. To run this test, I use Go and generic SQL database interface to interact with each database. Since it's not possible to scale SQLite for inserts, I decided to use a single thread or a single application Go routine to interact with both databases. For Postgres, I use a connection pool with a single connection. This means all queries are sent to the database one by one. There is no concurrency or parallelism in the application because, as you might expect, Postgres can handle concurrent queries while SQLite cannot. In concurrent scenario, Postgres would win every time. Alright, let's go ahead and run the first test. Yes, the Postgres client interacts over the network, so it's not entirely fair. But that's not the purpose of this benchmark. The goal is to show you the difference and give you an idea of how slow network interactions compare to using a local file system. On the right-hand side, we have the number of requests each database receives per second. Since I use a single thread in my application to send requests, I include artificial delay between them, which I gradually reduce over the time. This results in more queries per second. On the left-hand side, we have query latency. First is insert latency, and you can see a significant difference between SQLite and Postgres. Next, we have update query, which is one of the most resource-intensive operations. This is because it involves finding a record by its ID and updating its value. Finally, there is delete query. All three operations for Postgres performed over the network, while SQLite handles the same operations using local file system. I also measure CPU usage of the Postgres, then SQLite, which is actually the application itself using SQLite library, and the Postgres client, which only sends requests to the database and does nothing else. It's interesting to see the difference in CPU usage between Postgres client and the database, as both run on the same large instance with 2 virtual CPUs. At around 110 queries per second, Postgres shows CPU spikes, which directly translates to increased latency for all 3 types of queries. Despite this, the trend continues until the end. At around 200 queries per second, it's clear that SQLite can handle more requests because it takes significantly less time to process them. Now, let's see how many more queries per second SQLite can handle. Eventually, the delay is reduced to 0 milliseconds, meaning queries are sent as soon as the previous one completes. The full test took around 1.5 hours. Now, let me open each graph of the entire test, starting with the queries per second graph. It's no surprise that SQLite can handle more queries. This is because it doesn't need to send them over the network. The request per second RPS trend decreases over the time as the data volume grows, making updates slower, while insert latencies usually remain consistent. Next, we have insert latency. It remains mostly linear, except for a few spikes in the middle. If you have any insights into why these spikes occur, please let me know. Then there is update latency. As expected, the more data there is, the longer it takes to find and update an item. Updates are expensive operations, and even some big data frameworks like open source version of Spark do not support updates. Finally, we have delete latency. Similar to inserts, the latency stays relatively flat, except for some spikes in the middle. Now, let's look at CPU usage. Since application runs a single thread on a VM with two CPUs, the thread can only be executed on one CPU at a time, resulting in around 50% CPU usage by the end. You'll also notice that Postgres client has minimal CPU usage because it only sends and receives queries over the network. Lastly, we have disk write operations. Postgres uses disk much more intensively, while SQLite only flushes the buffer to the disk occasionally. If you run your infrastructure in AWS, keep in mind that they charge separately for disk IOPS, which is important if you use EBS or any other network file system. In my case, I use specialized i3EN instances where the cost of SSD disk is included in the price of the VM. Again, it's difficult to compare these databases directly because they are so different. However, I would love to hear any feedback or suggestions on how I can improve the tests. This test is more about demonstrating the cost associated with the network requests than directly comparing the databases. Essentially, I'm comparing concepts rather than individual technologies. Alright, let's go ahead and run the second test, where you will probably see the biggest difference. In this workflow, we start with just a single query and only a few requests per second. You'll notice significant spikes in latency at this stage, but as we increase the number of requests, these spikes will be reduced. Here, you can also see a huge difference in latency between these two applications. However, the biggest difference will be noticeable when we reach 0 millisecond timeout. When we remove any delay, we send as many queries to each database as they can handle. Since querying the local file system is faster than sending requests over the network, SQLite can process many more queries. Additionally, you can make a use of multi-core server for SQLite if you need to perform many reads or selects. Different threads or application instances can simultaneously access SQLite database file for reading without any limit. You can also share your SQLite database over the network using network file system, although inserts in that setup can be risky and unreliable. However, reading from the database over network is possible. Alright, let me show each graph for the full duration of the test. First, we have queries per second graph. Next, we have latency. Finally, we have CPU usage, which remains around 50% since we use a single thread. Let me know your thoughts on this test and any ways I can improve future tests. I also have other benchmarks that you can find in this playlist. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.